Hello, fellow mapmakers. I hope you can see me here and everything is working fine. And we are ready for another nice little mapping project for tonight. I'm Ralf Schemann of Profantasy Software, and I'll be showing you a bit of mapping with an overland style in tonight's video. It's a bit of a special thing today, or first thing, because we're going to do a preview of next week's annual issue, which is the Spectrum Overland Style, created by our last year's master mapper, Sue Daniel. And I loved it during creation of compilation of the style and doing an example map. And so I decided that I'm going to use it to preview the annual issue for you this week, which will also make for a nice reference video for anyone trying it out next week on the 1st of July. Also, welcome to all the new mappers who joined us recently from the Humble Bundle. I've seen a lot of new people coming into the Facebook group, and I hope you learn something new from this live mapping session. And I'm going to take care to take things slowly, explain what I'm doing, and explain a little bit of the interface to make this into a first-timers video as well. What you see at the screen right now is the example map that Sue created while creating the style. And from here, we're going to start and create a brand new map in the Spectrum Overland style. The map itself is shown in the drawing area of Campaign Cartographer. To the left of that is the symbol catalog, which shows the various symbols that can be placed in the map, as well as shortcuts to drawing tools. And to start a new map, we are going up past the catalog toolbar, which lets us switch between all the different symbol catalogs, up to the file toolbar, where we have the open button. So we're going to click that. Actually, that's not what I want to do. I wanted to click the new button and not the open button. We want to do a new map, not open an existing one. Not going to save the changes. They are saved anyway already. And then I get to choose the map type as the first thing in our new drawing wizard. And we're doing an overland map. So we're keeping this option here. And I'm clicking next. And then we've got the list of all the different overland map drawing styles we have available. It's quite a few by now. Lots of different annual issues have been overland styles. CC3 Plus comes with some, and other things like symbol sets add more drawing styles. Here you can see we have two options for the Spectrum Overland style. One without a notification is our standard Imperial, meaning miles and feet drawing style, and below that the metric if you want to use meters and kilometers. I'm going to stick with the miles for this one, so I'm just going to click next. And then we have the first setup page for the new drawing wizard, where we can set the dimensions of our map. This will be in miles, because I've chosen the Imperial template, and it's a good default size to start with. We're going to adjust that a little bit later. I'm going to show you something special there. And what we can also do, we can put in some an early map title and a copyright notice in here. Click one of these buttons and add a compass rose and scale bar already. But I'm going to do that later when I'm nearing the finishing my map. For now, I'm just going to click finish. And I'm going to save my map as a new example. And here's our blank drawing area. And the first default catalog has been loaded, and we are ready to start drawing the map. For this annual style, I've chosen for the map, I've chosen 1,000 by 800 miles, and I now want to reduce the size a little bit, mostly because it's will be a little bit large for us to complete in a live mapping session. So I want to make the area smaller, but keep the general symbol scale, so I don't have to place more symbols. For that, we do have a new command, or that's been introduced a few updates ago, the resize drawing area on the file toolbar. I'm going to click that, and here you can see our dimensions of the map that we currently have, and I want to make this smaller and do, say, a 600 by 450 miles map. Click Finish, and see it's just been shrunken down. I can use the zoom commands, which are on the left toolbars up here. This is zoom extends. That makes the map fill the drawing window. Okay, this is now 600 by 450 miles, and we're going to start by drawing our coastline. For that, we do have the landmass button up here, and I'm just going to click that, and the command line or the cursor tells me what it expects me to do. Select starting point for fractal polygon. So we're going to select the starting point and just click here, left click, and then it gives me a section of fractal path for my coastline. And each click gives me a new section, and this way I can draw my coastline. If I place something down and I don't like the section, I can always press delete, as the command line tells me to go back steps in the drawing process and start new. And I'm going to butt the landmass up to the map border by just clicking slightly beyond the border here. And then when I'm nearing my endpoint, I'm going to right click to finish the process. There's our coastline. Let's do a little refresh or redraw also here in the zoom tools, and that shows you the sheet effects that are applied to the coastline. Now we can use the same, just continue using the tool to add islands. One here, one here. You can also extend those beyond the map border. And what we can do, if you see the command line reads press E, then select an edge to edit an existing entity. I click E, get a little pick cursor, click on the coastline here, draw a peninsula, right click, and pick my endpoint, and the landmass is edited. Refresh to show the sheet effects on the whole map. It's looking quite nice already. So what's the next step? The next step for me is usually building mountain ranges on the map. And for that, we already have the Minerals and Mountains catalog open, but I can also switch to different catalogs. Perhaps I prefer to start with terrain features like grassy areas and things, deserts, or go back to the mountain ranges. One thing I just remember I wanted to show you is this style has two different sets of landmass drawing tools, and you can see these if we right click the default landmass tool. See, we've got, oops, that's a bit too quick. We've got a land green, a land brown, and the land default was the one I just used, and this is actually the same as the brown tool. So if you want to draw a section of landmass that's perhaps more fertile, or you want to generally have a green background to start with, you can choose this land green tool. But you can also use them in conjunction, and I wanted to show you that. If you just click the land green tool and say I want to draw a bit down here a little bit greener, I can just draw the landmass here, and I can use the trace function, T for trace, by selecting the coastline here, selecting a starting point, and then follow that coastline along. Right click to finish, and there we have a bit of green coastline. We're gonna hide the strong contrast between the brown and the green for later tools. Okay, back to our mountain ranges. We selected the mountain catalog and we have different sets of mountains here. So has very nicely created different climatic or geographic types of mountains, the standard ones, snow-capped ones, Arctic mountains, which are basically clad in all in ice and snow, and arid mountains, which have no greenery as around them. So we're going to just do the standard mountains for now. Click one of these, and you see, because I made my map area smaller, the mountains seem perhaps a bit large on the map, but it's going to be smaller if you use the standard size. So I'm just going to click one of the mountains, and you'll see that the symbol at the cursor changes. That's because there's a group of mountains behind this one symbol. And with the tab key, I can cycle through these different mountains. I can choose one that I want, a specific one, or I can just trust the random pick and let that create a nicely randomized mountain range as I place down the mountains. This is a very big one, so perhaps I don't want that. Let's choose another one. And there's my first bit of mountain range. I can mix in other mountain symbols too. So if you say I want some snow-capped mountains for a higher range behind the first one, I'm just going to place these down behind the ones. But you'll see that they don't overlap correctly. Now these higher or further back mountains appear actually on top of the others. To correct this, we have a tool called Sort Symbols and Map. This is so all the symbols get arranged correctly. I choose the command, right click to select everything in the map. It's just going to sort the symbols. It will have no effect on the other stuff. Right click again and choose Do It. And now you can see the mountains are nicely sorted correctly, that they overlap. And it looks good. So let's go to the hills. These work together with the mountains to give a nice range of foothills. See how nicely these blend together. Perhaps want some little bit more arid ones, not quite as green up here on top. And perhaps in the very north, put in some Arctic mountains and hills, so just I can show you the beautiful symbols. Again, I'm not going to bother about correct overlap. I'm going to fix that with the sort symbols command in a moment. There we go. And now, sort symbols and map. Everything. Do it. And there the symbols are sorted. Now I can put a little bit of mountain background behind the ones I've already drawn. I just outline the general area with the mountain background tool. Oh, it's actually fairly similar to the brown land tool, so might have not be necessary here, but just to show you the tool that it automatically puts the outline in the background behind the mountains. There's no re-rendering necessary here because these will go on different sheets. Campaign Cartographer puts them on the correct sheet automatically. All right, so much for the mountains. Now we need some rivers to flow to the sea. We can either use the sea and water or coast and sea tool to use these river tools here, or we can click the river button. Again, we can right click it to see a selection of different ones. And I'm going to show you the current width one, which means we can adjust the river width as we go along. And then this is the current width up here. This is our indicator bar, the one where all the values of the current entities are shown. And I'm gonna, let's say, I'm gonna do a 2 mile river width and try it out. Give it a see how this river looks when I draw it here. Sioux style is clever in that you don't need to exactly attach the river on the coastline. You can go slightly beyond. And if I do a refresh, you will see that the colors blend nicely from the river into the coast outline. And you get a nice river mouth there without any further adjustments. It's a good width. Now we could say, if I wanted to make it a bit smaller here at the top, I can do stuff. I can split the river in two. I've got the split command down here on the left toolbar. I click the split command, choose a point to split the river, and then change properties on the upper part. Right click, do it, and set the line width to say 1.2. And there's your smaller section. If you want to be, if you zoom in very closely, you'll see the step here from one width going to the other. If you're very meticulous and want to make this even nicer, you can go in and split the river again down here and change the line width of this piece to something in between. Between 1.2 and 2, it's 1.6. We go, and that way you can have a river that slowly goes wider to the coast. And let's do that again. And oops, that was the wrong tool I clicked. Current width, set it to slightly narrow, 1.5, and add a little river delta down here. For that, I'm going to use the on modifier, which is here, on, which is shortcut F9, to connect that bit of river to the original one. And another bit here, again extending slightly into the sea. Refresh, and there we have a little river delta, the river. Zoom out, and let's add a few more, perhaps a little bit smaller rivers. 1.2 is okay. Oh, let's, I have to click this first up here, set the width. And add a few rivers running from the mountains down to the sea. That looks good. And there's my rivers on the map. Now let's take a little break and have a look whether Sue's got any questions already for me. I think I saw a couple popping up. So Sue herself asks, can you use the undo button to undo land edits? Yes, you can do that. That's just a command like any other. Say I choose my land brown tool, edit this here, right click, finish, and do an undo, and that is undone. No problem at all. And Chris Garrett asks, when you resize a map, the symbol scale remains the same scale that the original map was sized at? Yes, that's important and different from when you actually choose a different map size to start with. With an overland map, the symbol scale will adjust to the size you choose, so you don't get overwhelmed with too large or too small symbols on a, if you choose very large or small values on an overland map. But if you change the map size afterwards, it will keep the originally chosen scale. So that's a good option if you want to do maps at a different symbol scale than the default size. Okay, we've got our rivers down, and now we do need some terrain features to show on the map. For that, we're gonna load the vegetation catalog first and show some of the terrain tools available here. We've got some grass and marsh and different terrain textures. Let's start by making some of our area a bit more green here. See, we've got the nice green hills, and I guess that's gonna look much better if we have some matching green background here. Again, you can trace existing lines like the coastline, just follow that along. And a bit of an outline here, go behind the mountains. There's my green background. Perhaps make the some of the river valleys a little bit darker, richer, more fertile. Just outline the areas. And you're going to see in a second that refreshing the sheet will show you that they nicely blended to each other. I'm noticing a little thing that bugs me a little bit. That's the river mouth here. That's really extending too far into the sea, and you see the light blue against the darker sea background. So I'm just going to show you how to edit this. So I'm just going to choose the move node, or node edit command. Grab the end of the river here, move it up. Refresh, and there you see, much better. That way you can edit almost everything that you've placed on the map. See, you've still got the harsh green-brown line here, so we're going to put some more textures across that. Say here it's a bit drier here, we've got some plains areas. Just going to add here. And you see it's vanishing a lot. It's because of the sheet effect. And it's a good opportunity to load up the sheets and effects list. This is our list of sheets for the map. You see we were working on the savanna. Oh no, actually we were using the plains. And this has an edge fade inner effect. I'm going to edit that. And you can see it's a 50-mile edge transition from 100% opacity in the middle to zero on the outside. Since we're working on a fairly small map, this doesn't leave much in the middle or to actually show. So we're going to put that down to 10 units, 10 miles in this case. And there you can see we have more of the planes showing. Add some. Perhaps, let's see, do we want to use more of the plains or some, perhaps use a bit of savanna up here in the corner. Nice. And some more drier grass here. Let's follow the coastline again. To here. Some grassy areas. Okay, we're gonna need a bit more up here in the north, so we're gonna zoom in a bit with the zoom window command, which lets you zoom to a specific section of the map. Let's load the natural features catalog, and actually this is a good test run because I think I am missing one of the terrain tools in the catalog. So we're going to click on the terrain button, and this will bring up the list of terrain drawing tools, and we've got the snow here. This is the one I was looking for because I wanted to add a bit of snow outline to the snowy mountains and hills up here. That's the one. And further on, I have this nice tundra tool, which can go here across the brown hills. There we go. That's pretty nice. You can always go in later if you want to add a few more things. So let's call it enough terrain for the moment, except for some forests. We do need a little bit of forests on our map, of course. We've got several different options. Here we've got a normal deciduous type of forest, pine forest, a snowy one, and an autumn colored forest tool. These are tools to draw bigger forests all in one go. You can also build them up from this individual tree symbols, but I wanted to show you the forest tools first. So let's click the default forest tool. Say I want a nice foresty area here in the center of my map. Outline the area and then right click to finish. And the tool fills the whole area with trees. It tends to look a little bit too regular at the edges, so we're going to go in and add some individual ones to have a more natural looking edge for the river here. Create some little less densely populated tree areas. This big forest. So one thing I can show you is to mix in a few pine trees here in the near the hills and the mountains. You can just plop a few pine trees along the edges, and again then use the sort symbols command as previously to sort all the symbols. One thing you might notice is, for example, take this bit here, that this tree slightly vanishes behind the hill. That's because the hill symbols are so much larger and the insertion point which controls the sorting of the symbols doesn't quite match the tree stuff. But for that we do have an extra sheet. So if you say you want some trees that are actually on the slopes of the hills or mountains, you can switch your active sheet to the symbols front sheet. And if you now place some trees on the slopes, and even if you do sort symbols and map them, these will remain on top of everything else because they are on a drawing sheet later in the order of the drawing. So that looks nice. Let's add a little terrain, a pine tree forest up here near the coast. The trick I can show you is you can just draw behind the mountains, fill the area with trees, and then do your sort operation. No, wrong selection. All. It will put the trees nicely behind the hills and mountains. Sort them. We can then go in again, liven up the edges. And so the hills aren't quite bare, change to the symbols front sheet and put some individual pine symbols on the slopes of the hills and mountains. Looks quite natural. And just to show you the snowy tree forest, let's do a similar thing up here. is our snowy tree symbols. Sort them all and add some along the edges. Symbols front. And there we go. You can also do full autumn trees, but as the map should probably not really show a climatic the state of the seasons, I usually prefer to just mix the autumn trees in with some of the greener trees to add some variety to the map. And it a little bit more color, which just looks nice. And again, once we're done, I'm doing this a little bit too often here just for demonstration purposes. You can always do the symbol sorting operation fairly much at the end of the drawing process. And for sort of things, some little changes. See here, this tree I placed perhaps a little bit too smack on the river. So I'm just gonna move that around. Don't be put off if you see these white outlines when you pick up a symbol. That's because to save you time and enjoying the map, Campaign Cartographer doesn't automatically refresh the screen every time you do an operation like picking up the symbol. So this is just a screen artifact to show you. If I do a redraw, it's gone. And once I place it down and zoom again, it would have been gone anyway. So one more thing I wanted to add terrain and vegetation wise is the farmland texture. And because that's in overlay in this drawing style, very nicely done by Sue, you can simply add the farmland texture to any background and it will overlay the hedges over the background you have in the terrain. Again, with the edge fade effect to blend it nicely into the background. I use this to highlight or show civilized areas where people live and farm. So this goes mostly in the fertile areas and the river valleys. You could put it on the snow, of course, but I guess that would not make much sense. There's our farmland. Here I'm going to go in and add a little bit more forest in these individual trees to fill out the area here. And we've still got this island here, I guess. I'm going to a little bit of forest on this one as well. Let's start out with the forest tool and add a few normal and autumn trees around the edges. The coast here as well. And a terrain tool that I haven't used so far is the marshes. Swamps here. This looks like a good area for that. Let's trace over. This is a low-lying coastal area, salt marshes and stuff in my imagination. So that looks good. Yeah, I like it. And let's do this on the other side of the strait here as well. Just fill the whole area with the swamp bitmap fill. and add a couple of trees also here on the edge. Good, I've seen another question here coming in. We'll just should mention again, if you have any questions, post them in the Facebook comments of the video, and Sue will forward them to me so I can answer them during the video. Okay, can you insert those autumn trees into the middle of the green mass of trees and hem them sawed in? It's going to be a bit difficult because the center of the forest it does not consist of individual symbols. Instead, it's a whole bunch of trees in one image. I'm going to show you by selecting them here. See the purple outlines? These are the individual symbols that make up the forest. You can scatter in some autumn trees, and they will probably not show up all of them, but a few of them might at the edges of the other images. So let's do a sort, see how this goes. No, most of them are actually hidden behind the larger symbol blocks. So that's something, you have to scatter them around the edges. You can't put them into the center of the forest. Might be a good idea to add a bit more of mixed area forest tools that let you create forests with these mixed type of symbols. See whether I can add that to the annual before it gets released next week. Okay, we've got forests, we've got individual trees, we've got swamps. Now we've got the need the people to live in this area. And for this, we're going to switch to the structure symbols. Actually, there we go. These are the symbols with the structures, cities, towns, castles, and so on. And I'm going to start out by placing down a city. Here, the river mouth, always a good place for a city. And to show you the varicolor symbols, the ones in the right column of the symbols can be adjusted by color. If you choose, for example, a blue, the roof of the houses will adjust to the same to the chosen color. So let's put on a blue-roofed city down here at the edge of the drier area. Then add a town down here, a village up near the mountains, and perhaps a hamlet here at the edge of the forest. Over here, do the same. I often like to show different allegiances or different countries by choosing different roof colors. Well, that's always an option. Town up here, village here, and a few hamlets. Up here in the mountains is good. You can do bridges. If you, this is a group of symbols again with different directions for the bridges, as you can see. You can also always use the tab key to cycle through the symbols in a collection. This is perfect this way. Let's do another bridge here. And let's pick a castle. Where do we want to put a castle? Should probably be somewhere on the border between these two countries, so I'm going to put it near to the bridge here. And a watchtower here. Again, I want to place this on top of the hill, so I'm going to do the same as with the trees. I'm going to switch to the symbols front sheet and place the tower up here. And that way it's going to stick on there, even if I do a simple operation later. As you can see down here with the trees, I do need to do a sorting operation. So I'm going to do sort the map, everything. And here I do need to either put the castle on top or move some of the trees around, which one I'm going to do. That way we still have the one tree nicely on top of the castle, in front of the castle, and the others are separate. Okay, and perhaps put in a few neutral, say brown roofed hamlets up here into the wilderness beyond the mountains. One here. This is a nice spot for a hamlet, and one here at the base of the mountain. So we can also, oh, one other thing we have is a very nice stave church symbol, which I really should put on the map somewhere. Let's put that here. Can always scale symbols, even different from the default scale, by holding down control and moving the mouse cursor up and down. So if you want to be something be larger or smaller than the standard, you can do that. You right click, you can set it back to the normal standard size for the symbols. Okay. It's looking not net. Perhaps we can switch to the natural features catalog for some special type of thing. We've got a nice volcano symbol here. Oops, a bit overwhelming for our map, but might be nice up here. Oh, certainly should take away the settlement there. Well, you never know, people sometimes build close to volcanoes in the real world. Put the volcano up here. And what else have we got? If you right click on the symbol catalog toolbar, it will open up the selection window across the whole screen, and you can do things like pick up symbols from there. So let's put a geyser here. An active one. Close to the settlement here. Oh, let's put it. Yeah, that looks good. This looks nice, but I'm finding it's a little bit sparse down here, perhaps. And oops. Let's add a few more trees. A few scattering of trees always living up fertile areas, so it's always a good thing to do at the end, or see where you can put some more variation into the map by just simply adding some trees. We've got some special dead pine trees as well. These look good if added in some isolated places. Or you can even go in and build a whole dead forest or section of dead forest with them. Let's sort the symbols once more. So, what is missing for the cities and towns? Some roads to connect them. We can load the structures catalog, scroll down, and you can see some road tools down here. So let's start with the major road and have it run all along the coast, across the two bridges, down to this town here, then connect some outlying stuff with minor roads. You can use the on modifier again, the F9 key to connect roads to existing ones. And something up here. And let's see whether we can build a nice pass across the mountains somewhere. It's not the best location. But if we can always add stuff. So say we have got a little village up here. Take the mine around tool again, click to connect to this the road down here. We do need a section running to the tower here anyway. And then run this as a pass across the mountains. I'm going to show you something. Because if I do refresh now, what you can see, the road vanishes behind the mountain symbols. Well, the road sheet is behind the mountain sheet, the symbol sheet, so it doesn't show. But we can do stuff like split the road here. Oh, that was the wrong entity. For that, because we've got lots of overlapping entities here now, we can should freeze everything but the structures layer, freeze all. See the little F symbol here on the layers means these can't be edited now. And now I'm going to split. Oh, of course I shouldn't. Now did the tool perhaps put the road on the wrong sheet? Let's check it by thawing everything first and do a list command on the road. This shows me the properties of an entity. Do it. It's on the sheet roads and it's on the layer standard actually. Okay, that's not something that it should be. Something I'm gonna change before releasing that. See, this is a good test for the style. We're gonna switch to the layer standard anyway. And freeze everything. And now we're gonna edit the road. Also in this little section down here. Split it into several pieces. And now we're gonna do move to sheet on the sections that should be on top of the symbols. Do it. And we're going to put it on the road's front sheet, which is above the symbol sheet. And now you can see the road nicely running across the mountains and across the hill down here. Okay, let's take a little look at the questions that have come in so far. Fill error with symbols. Yes, you can also use the fill error with symbols command with the tree symbols. I might set up a tool for that because that allows you to do a little more scattered forest. That's a good idea, actually, something to add to the drawing style. Same goes for Christian's question about the forest tool with placed individual trees. That's going to be done with that. Okay, I'm not sure I've got the time to actually show that in this video because I still want to add some labels and stuff. So I'm going to keep that for another time. Because we're all almost done. With the content of the map, we just need to add some of the extra bits like text labels and compass roses. And let's do the compass rose first. If you click the borders catalog, it gives you compass rows that you can place on the map. This is actually perhaps a little bit too small even, so I'm going to increase the size by holding down Control key. For compass rows on scale bar, I like to turn on the snap, so the symbol snap to a fixed grid on the map. You can also show the grid to see the points where it snaps to, because that allows me to align the compass rows and scale bar in a way they look matching. See, this is where the compass rows goes. Then I'm going to choose the scale bar. At scale 1, this is going to be exactly 100 miles, although our standard scale bars are scaled that way. But I can change the... We are at actually 1.5 scale here. I wanted to even a bit larger, so I'm going to do 2 scale. So this is going to be 200 miles. Is this correct? Looks a bit short. I'm going to check in a second. Going to place this first and put in the number that should appear on the scale bar for 200 miles. Finished. Might still be misscaled, the symbol. This is what the scale bar says. If I go info, distance, I want to measure the distance from this point to this point. See, it's only 100 miles, so my scale bar is probably misscaled in the symbol catalog. Something's to fix before I release this annual. So let's undo this, choose the scale bar again, do not snap, place it, and just put in the 100. There's our 100 miles of the map. So next we do need a bit of a title for the map. For that I'm going to switch to the text title sheet. Choose a nice darkish blue color. The text is title text is set up to be used with a darker color. And in the text properties, I can choose my font I want to use. Middle Ages is actually the style for the title, for the style, the text properties for the style. And well, let's leave the height of the text and do it visually. So how do we call that? Those are the Northlands. Actually, it looks more like it's the Southlands, from with the landmass extending down from the north. So let's call it the Southlands of Hilgorth. And see, you can see the text there. Turn on snap here. You can scale this. You can choose the alignment. Can choose where to place the text, but I think I want to not put this in one line. It's a bit too long for that, so I'm going to edit the text afterward, after placing it. I've got the edit tool down here on the left toolbar. Click that, click the baseline of your text. You always have got to select text by clicking on the baseline, and choose the multi-line option, and then edit this to be 3 lines. See, that looks quite nice. Can still move this a bit further here. There's our title for the map. And then we switch to the normal text style. Choose a bright color, like a very light gray, and then we can put it in text for the cities. Of course, we need to make this smaller now. Let's zoom in a bit. You can align the text by hitting R for right align and B for bottom. So the alignment is the lower right corner. It's now a bit large. And again, hit L for left alignment, or you could go C for center, right, left, or B for bottom, M for middle, and T for top. See, for that normal text, we've got a dark outline to make a bright text color stand out nicely. So I'm not going to label all the towns and villages here. It's just going to take me a little bit too long, but I do want to show you the text along a curve command, because that's nice to label some mountains or rivers. For that, I'm going to switch to the text labels layer and freeze everything else, so because I'm going to need to select something. Second, and you can now draw a smooth path or an arc where you want your text to go. This is going to be the line for my text, and now I can do draw text along a curve, select the curve, and type in my text. Let's call it the Karaskar Mountains, something dwarven. My curve text label. You can move and scale that around, but you won't be able to edit it like normal text at the moment, because it's a group of letters, basically. Better curve text features in the works for future editions, but for now this works well enough to do some curved labels on the map. And finally, we have another text sheet prepared, Text Ocean. This is also for some blue, perhaps a bit brighter text. And there we can put in, can turn the multi-lines option. Let's call it the Northern Sea. Center. The size a bit and see this is blends nicely into the sea background. Again, let's do a little curved text bit and draw text along a curve. This is going to be the Hill Goth. Straight. What you can do, you can make the text a bit smaller, perhaps. See if I'm gonna. You can do change text properties on this here. Right click, do it. See, currently it's 15, a bit too large for my taste, so let's make it 12.5. And we'll adjust every letter individually to be a bit smaller. See, still looks good. Okay, and that looks pretty much like a nice little map for 1 hour drawing session. And we can check whether we've got any more questions from people. Christian likes the amount of sheets I have prepared, which is wrong, because actually Sue prepared all the sheets. I just adjust them a little bit, added a couple more, but not many. All the sheet setup and most of the sheet effects is all work by Sue, so praise where praise belongs. Remy correctly corrects me that I don't need to unfreeze layers to use list. which is a good point. We had a while ago, a couple of patches ago, we still had to use that, but not anymore, which is very useful if you want to find out stuff. List command, because it doesn't change anything, allows you to actually select stuff from frozen layers. Perhaps something I might not use on this map, but which comes in handy for many people, is add a little bit of grit to the map. See, I've chosen a bright color for that, and I can now go in, draw hex or square overlay. Say you want a 40-mile hex grid, horizontally aligned, no labels in the grid, apply. There's the hex grid on the map. And see, it's very soft, or basically vanished. Let's take a look at the grid. It's got a blur and blend mode. It's probably a bit too strong for this size of map. There's the grid again. So if you just want to do a little bit of softening to the background, you can see what's the opacity, say 90%. Apply. Still vanishes pretty much. Let's do it with a different sheet effect, with the transparency effect. Say only 50% opacity. And there you've got a nicely soft grid on the map. And if you don't want to see it for printing or displaying, you can just turn off the grid sheet. And now we've created a nice little extra example map for the drawing style. And I'm looking forward to make a few little adjustments to the style which came up here. Always useful to do an example map like that. And release the style next Wednesday, I think it's the 1st of July. And with that, the July issue of the Cartographer's Annual. Check it out if you want to. And talk to you again next week. Bye-bye.